exhibition all around you, really takes a deeper look at some of the issues surrounding water, mostly in the U.S., but also internationally. And all of these artists are taking somewhat of an activist stance. I think bringing awareness to these issues is really important, and bringing it to the forefront. It's kind of the first step in activism. But I want to know, I want to ask and learn, what are the next steps? What can we do to make a difference beyond just bringing out awareness? What can we do to affect change? So tonight we have a great opportunity to have a dialogue with Lennon Kowchek and Matt Jenkins, who both have a lot of experience and ideas around social action and activism. I hope you'll take advantage of their insight and have dialogue with them, share your responses and comments and questions as they're talking tonight. They both collaborated on an artwork that's in the exhibition, if you haven't made your way around yet, a piece over here, titled Water from Flint, Michigan, and I don't remember the date, June 10th of 2017. Lynna Kowchek was the National Infrastructure Campaign Manager for Food and Water Watch. In that role, she supported and helped lead Food and Water Watch's campaign work to develop long-term solutions for our nation's aging water infrastructure. She also worked on water privatization, fights, and water affordability. Before joining Food and Water Watch, Lynna worked for Clean Water Action, where she organized local, state, and federal environmental and electoral campaigns. Lynna earned her bachelor's degree from Michigan State University in resource development and her master's degree from Florida Institute of Technology in Environmental Education. Matt Jenkins is assistant professor of art at MSU Denver and an active artist working in socially engaged art, performance art, video art, internet art, and environmental art. His work focuses on a variety of explorations into history, cultural studies, the American Southwest, climate change and environment, feminism, technology, and critical race theory. Quite a broad span. His work has shown nationally and internationally. He holds a BA in art from Adams State University, an MA in American Studies from the University of New Mexico, and an MFA in Emergent Digital Practices from the University of Denver. Please welcome our speakers tonight.
Well, thank you, everyone. So Lynn and I have a plan tonight to show you and sort of talk to you about some basics, tell you the Flint story. And we were also hoping though, to have some kind of dialogue with you guys, have some questions and answers. So we don't want to do a traditional kind of lecture, but we do want to get started kind of telling you a little bit about the work and about Flint. I'll kind of start with beginning from my point of view in terms of the show. When I first heard from Cecily about the show and the idea behind the show, I thought right away about Flint, and I thought to myself, let's get some water from Flint here somehow as a work. And I can be honest with you in the sense that at the time I almost wasn't thinking of it as a work of art necessarily. I was just kind of thinking of it as something that needed to happen. So that we could sort of materialize the discourse around water, polluted water, and stuff like that. So I started reaching out over the internet to people I didn't know, researching the Flint story, and I came across Lynna on the Food and Water Watch webpage, emailed her, and said, can I ask you to help me with this art project, which is, I need water from Flint, and I don't know anybody in Flint. And Lynna emailed me back right away and said, you're in luck, I think it's a great idea, we're going to Detroit in a couple days, right? So we hadn't met before over coffee, and then I went and came back with some Nalgene bottles full of water, which you see over there on the pedestal in a picture with a glass. So this water came from the home of Melissa Mays, who's a really well-known activist, one of the leaders, definitely, in the Flint story, and it came from her tap, from her kitchen sink, on June 10th of this past summer. So that's fresh water from Flint, Michigan. Should we start with Melissa?
Yeah.
Okay. So she's kind of our third contributor here. And you have to excuse me, I'm gonna go back and forth between the web and the PowerPoint. here, but let's hear.
My name is Melissa Mays, and I am a resident of Flint, Michigan. I'm also a mother of three wonderful sons and a clean water activist. For the past 3.5 years, Flint residents have not had access to clean, safe, or affordable water. For the past 2.5 years, myself and other amazing Flint residents have been fighting this. We've been fighting against the water shutoffs as well as the poisoning of our water, and not just from lead. There are cancer-causing disinfection byproducts. We have so many carcinogens in our water. Lots of chloroform, which of course is one of those movie things that you don't think would be in your shower, but we have that. But the most alarming is we have really high levels of very dangerous pathogens in the water. So for people who have compromised immune systems, like the poisoned, it is very dangerous to take a shower here in Flint. So we have to stand up and we fight. But we don't just fight for Flint. We know that it's not just happening to us. But we do know that if we do not stand up and fight for our rights to clean, safe, affordable water, that no other city is going to get fixed if we don't. We know with all the attention that Flint has gotten, which has led to some good, some bad things, that if they don't fix us properly and do what's right by us, they're not going to do anything for the next city that gets poisoned or the city that's currently poisoned. So we fight. We fight in the labs. We do water testing. We have had to learn science inside and out, especially when it comes to water treatment and water chemistry. We fight in the courts. We have to file lawsuits because the state of Michigan who poisoned us is not going to do anything to fix us out of the goodness of their hearts, or they would have already. And we have to fight in the streets. We march, we protest, we get in front of our legislators. We go to DC, we go to Lansing, we go all over the place to fight. And I have been fortunate enough to travel to other cities and states having water problems as well, to teach them how to organize and how to fight back. Because you are your own hero. You don't sit around and wait for a knight in shining armor to save you, because that will never happen. What happens is when a so-called expert pops in, they can take away your narrative and control of the entire crisis. So retain your expertise. My biggest advice to anyone and everyone is to go with your gut, to stand up and fight, that your voice, every single voice is important, and that you are the expert in your crisis. So no matter what it is, whether it's clean water, soil, air, it doesn't matter, any kind of human rights violations, you stand up and you fight. You have it in you, whether you believe it or not. Don't wait until you are poisoned like we are, like my sons are, like I am. Don't wait until you're too tired and too sore to move to say, hey, something's not right here. Look at us, look what's been done to us in Flint and what's still happening. We are in day 1,243 and counting, and it's a scary, scary situation. But you stand up, you fight. You fight for yourselves, you fight for your rights, you fight for neighbors, and you fight for your children in the future. Because if that doesn't change, nothing changes, water will be completely treated like a commodity. And the one thing that we have learned from Flint is when water is treated like a commodity, people die. Ira, what are you fighting for here in Flint? And you can find me at W-A-T-E-R, water, youfightingfor.com. I am FlintGate on Twitter because I'm kind of clever. And I also am the project director at Flint Rising, which is focused on building community power. It's something that every single city that's going through every kind of tragedy needs to do. The power is within the people. So remember this. Stand together and stand strong. Thank you. And please, please, don't forget about Flint. And hopefully it never does, but if this happens to you, we'll stand with you too. Thank you.
What next?
Let's go to
this
the
one?
Person.
Okay.
No, just the person.
Oh, there's a problem.
Detroit, there's people who live without water because their reservoirs have been drained,
agriculture, or their wells have been poisoned because of gravel mining. It's widespread throughout the state, and it's really, I think, when you look at a map of the Great Lakes, it's kind of staggering to think of people living in the middle of all this water and not having access to it. So here we are in Michigan, surrounded by 20% of the world's fresh available surface water, but it's not safe in Flint. And what I wanted to pose the first question to y'all is, you know, what are the implications of that? Whether you live in Flint and you turn your faucet on and it's not safe, or whether you live in Detroit and you turn your faucet on and nothing comes out because you can't afford to pay for it, what are the implications for that for your daily life?
Say here we are using terms of the ability to just go to any faucet anywhere and get a glass of water if we're thirsty. But
right, you just, you know, you think you turn it on, it's going to be there. Yeah, you can drink something. But there, I mean, you have drinking, because I think that's naturally one of the first things we all think of. What are other things that you can't do if you don't have this resource?
So it's essentially like washing anything, like your clothes, your dishes, yourself. And it's kind of one of those things, like, when you really look at your daily life, like, how much is surrounded by water, and if you didn't have any, like, how much, like, impeded. Like, it almost, like, holds it.
You can't cook. Like, one thing that I've learned from, there was this woman that I worked with in Detroit, named Nicole, and she's telling me, she's like, you know, well, what's cooking like? And she's like, well, we don't eat rice or pasta because we would never make anything that absorbed water because then we can't reuse it. So that's one thing that I think of. And like with kids, you had mentioned that you can't bathe. Well, can you imagine what it's like to go to school if you weren't able to take a bath in the morning or wash your clothes? And like this type of social stigma that comes with that, or not being able to tell your teacher that you don't have water because then they have to report it to Human Services. And you can be taken away from your parents. So beyond just not being able to drink, there are staggering implications from not being able to have water coming out of your tap, and I think it's something that we don't necessarily think about right away. We kind of think about the drinking aspect. In Melissa's case, she mentioned the showers. That is a huge problem in Flint right now. So she mentioned the chloroform. Chlorine is something that is used to treat water, but when chlorine comes in contact with organic and inorganic materials, other chemicals are created. And in the United States, we don't have standards for what is safe to bathe or shower. Other countries do, European countries do. We do not. So a lot of people in Flint are getting sick from the gases that are coming out of their showers. So I could probably sit here and talk about the water crisis in Detroit for hours. So what I talked to Matt about is that one of the things that has been really important in both of these crises are images. And they've been a really important way to tell the story about what's happening and raise awareness about what is going on in these cities. And so I thought I'd start with this one because if you Google the Flint water crisis, any article you see is going to come up with this. This is kind of like, this image now is like synonymous with what's going on. And so I thought we would start here. So this is essentially a timeline, based on what is in my head, of what happened. But don't worry, we are not going to go through this, but it's here. And so I wanted to hit on a couple of key points. And the first is the very first thing that happened in 2011. We had a new governor come into the state of Michigan, and one of the very first things that they did is pass an emergency manager law. And what that did was take away, so if a community or a school district was cash strapped, then the state could come in and help them get their finances in state. In check. And what it did is it took away the power of the mayor and the city councils. So they were essentially ran like a dictatorship. This happened in both Flint and Michigan, and all the communities that it happened in were predominantly communities of color. And one of the very first things that they did in every single community was try to privatize the water system, because the water system was the community's asset. So the emergency manager law was really important. It was an emergency manager that made the decision to switch to the Flint River in 2014. So I'm going to have you play the video about it, and we'll let Amy Goodman kind of explain the timeline for me.
Again, for a Democracy Now! Special. Thirsty for democracy, the poisoning of an American city. In April 2014, an unelected emergency manager appointed by Michigan Governor Rick Snyder switched the source of Flint's drinking water from the Detroit system, which they've been using for half a century, to the corrosive Flint River. Officials thought they could save something like $5 million. Soon after, Flint residents were complaining about discolored and foul-smelling water, which was causing a host of health problems. First, the water was infested with bacteria. To treat the bacteria, the city poured in chlorine, which created a cancerous chemical byproduct called trihalomethanes, or TTHMs, a deadly outbreak of Legionnaire's disease, which is caused by a waterborne bacteria that spread through Flint, killing 10 people and sickening dozens. At the same time, underground, the Flint River water was corroding Flint's aging pipes, poisoning the drinking water with lead, which can cause permanent damage, especially in children. Well, this past weekend, we went to Flint to learn the remarkable story of how Michigan Governor Rick Snyder and other officials ignored and covered up residents' complaints for a year and a half.
Last December, but they still haven't received the money yet, so the state of Michigan has it. It's
to replace the pipes, but they're not actually giving the city the money yet. The state also gave them $128 million, but again, it's a slow process. It's going to be at least another 3 years before all the pipes are replaced. And then the one other thing that I want to note on the timeline is that there was a Flint advisory task force that was put in place, and the Michigan Civil Rights Commission did an investigation into the crisis. And both of their reports showed that racism played a role in the Flint water crisis, which I think is significant. If this would have happened in one of the wealthier suburbs, it would have been taken care of right away. So like I said, I think images play a very important role in any of the issues I think that I've worked on over the years. And I think this is one that is particularly staggering, because this is tap water from different homes in Flint. And this water is coming out of people's homes, and their city, their state is telling them there is nothing wrong with it. Again, I love this image. This image, so when the folks in Detroit and the folks in Flint met in the summer of 2015, towards the end of May, we realized right away that there was a big connection between the two communities. And so the activists organized a walk. And they walked from Detroit to Flint over the course of 10 days. And this is when they arrived at Flint City Hall. So this woman, Lila Cavill, is an amazing water activist. She actually was Rosa Parks' personal assistant for 30 years. She's amazing. And she did a lot of the walk. This is Melissa, and this is them making it all the way to Flint. And I think that that's a powerful image. As well as this, Baxter, he's another amazing water warrior. A key role of part of the way to play. This is us delivering almost 30,000 petition signatures to the mayor of Flint, asking them to switch back to Detroit's water system. And we tried to get a meeting with the mayor for weeks and could not get a meeting with him. We showed up at his office. That's him. He's not living here anymore. I was driving back to Detroit after this happened, and I get a call on my cell phone. It was the mayor. Apparently, if you show up at 30,000 petitions, you can get a meeting with them. So I think it's just a testament to show that, like, when you get organized and you get people involved, you can put pressure on people that you need to do something, you can get them to do something. But sometimes it takes a lot of time. So one of the things that happened when the news finally broke, so the thing that really kind of the catalyst, I guess, that's brought a national and international awareness to the issue was a physician from the Flint area realized that there was an increase in blood lead levels in children in Flint. And that was significant because even though it was only a 3% increase, lead levels in children had been declining for about 2 decades, so it reversed a trend. And that's when everyone started paying attention. And one of the first things that happened is that trailers, trucks, like, from all over, like, you know, this fraternity in North Carolina or this, you know, choir in New York, people were just from all over the country sending huge semis full of bottled water to Flint to help, which was great. But it makes you think, who is getting rich off of the Flint water crisis?
Yeah. So another player in the Flint story is Nestle. So Nestle has, that's the third one?
The third one.
Okay. Nestle has purchased for almost nothing, right?
Like a few $100.
Yeah, the rights to pull water out of an aquifer up towards Lake Superior?
Lake Michigan.
So And wasn't the wife of one of the mayor's chief of staff?
The wife of the governor's chief of staff, Deb Matchmore, is a lobbyist for the bottled water and the oil and gas industry in Michigan. She was instrumental in getting them exempt from Michigan's water withdrawal laws. And they played a significant role in this race. I mean, Amy will talk about
it.
I'm Amy Goodman. This is Democracy Now! Special, Thirsty for Democracy, the poisoning of an American city. Well, as Flint residents are forced to drink, cook with, and even bathe in bottled water while still paying some of the highest water bills in the country for their poisoned water, we turn to a little-known story about the bottled water industry in Michigan. In 2001 and 2002, the Michigan Department of Environmental Quality issued permits to Nestle, now the largest water bottling company in the world, to pump up to 400 gallons of water per minute from aquifers that feed Lake Michigan. This sparked a decade-long legal battle between Nestle and the residents of Wacosta County, where Nestle's water wells are located. One of the most surprising things about this story is that in Wacosta County, Nestle is not really required to pay anything to extract the water besides a small permitting fee to the state and the cost of a lease to a private landowner. In fact, the company received $13 million in tax breaks from the state of Michigan to locate the plant there. The spokesperson for Nestle Michigan is Deborah Matchmore. She's the wife of Dennis Matchmore. That's Michigan Governor Rick Snyder's chief of staff, who he just retired and registered to be a lobbyist. When we reached out to Nestle for comment on the story, we didn't speak with Deborah Matchmore, but we did speak with Jane Lazen of Nestle Waters, who said, quote, "We're deeply invested in the Muskegon River watershed and its sustainability. Our water use is always permitted and compliant with the permitting authorities," unquote. But residents of Wacosta County have another story to tell. So let's take a look at Nestle and the battle over the Great Lakes.
So Nestle got ripped off by crisis. And in fact, in the beginning there was, I want to say it was roughly $20 million that was set aside to provide bottled water, and much of that came with ice mountain water. So here you have Nestle taking water for free and then selling it back to the state. So now the taxpayers are paying Nestle to provide water to Flint on the, you know, for the crisis that the state created.
It's unbelievable.
I really like this image. These, I forget where these women were from, but they were aid workers that had been working in another country and then came to Flint to help deliver water. Or they may have been from the U.S., but they had been previously distributing water in another country. This is everywhere in Flint. I think these are might be from the city building, but you know, wherever you go, and it was interesting for me the first time I went there, like going to the bathroom, and like you can't wash your hands because you can't use the water, so there's like these bottles and they're all everywhere you go. And even just recently when I was there picking up the water this summer, I was out for lunch with Melissa, and she's like, "What do you want to drink?" I'm like, "Just water." She's like, "Do you have water?" I'm like, "Oh, sorry." So you can't drink a lot of water. I like this image a lot. I think it's pretty powerful. So one of the things that had to happen right away was just all the children under six and Flint need to be tested to make sure that they have poison. Although, I think it's like you have to do it within a certain amount of days with the contact with or ingesting the water, or like your number goes down. I'm not a doctor, so I can't really explain it very well, but there's a lot of issues, right? And I think one thing to note too is that for the children that have suffered from lead poisoning, this is something that they're going to be dealing with for a lifetime. It has, you know, lifetime.
9,000 children, upwards of 9,000 children, but not lead poisoning for life.
This I've been here because so this is the Detroit Light Brigade, and they've gone around, they've gone all over the state and the Great Lakes, and with their water boards and or light boards, and I think this is just a really interesting way to call attention to different issues. And so what they'll do is they'll take them down the street and they stand over top of the interstate with their light boards, so just to bring awareness to the issue. This is awesome. So this is another picture you can go, you'll see kids pretty much everywhere. But it really, I think it's, these kids were great. I hung out with them for a little while and like they got it. You know, it was really interesting and they were so proud of their signs. Like, you know, their mom helped them with their signs and they came up with the things that they wanted to write on them. And I think it's just again another. No, but he gave a bunch of money to Flint. I can't remember, he's a musician, but anyways, he came to town and helped Snoop. What? Snoop is not Snoop. But he was a little bit of a moderator. We can probably know it. Another thing is when they first started providing water, you had to go, well, you still have to go to a fire station to pick it up. And this was in January, and when I was going door to door, many of the people that I talked to were, I would say the majority of people I talked to, because we were in Section 8 housing neighborhood, were women, they were seniors, and they were people of color. And every single one of them looked like they were not going out in 20 degree weather to go pick up water, so they have, you know, friends and neighbors and family that were helping to, you know, get the water, but if you didn't have a car, you had to walk to pick it up. Eventually, they allowed me to take a bus for free to go to one of those places to pick up water. But I mean, people, then you could only get one case per family per day. So people were having to go every single day to pick up their one case of water. This is a photo that was National Geographic. This is probably one of my favorites. It's just another really striking photo of, you know, kids. You know, when we think of people going to gather, you know, get their water every day and they have to go to a well to get it, we think of a third world country, and that's what's happening every day in Flint, and it's been like this for 3 years. And so this is World Water Day. We went to the Capitol in Lansing, and it's water activists from all over the state, but predominantly from Detroit and Flint. This is the woman, Nicole, I was talking about, who told me you can't cook rice, you don't have water, you eat too much. And she was without water two separate times. I think the longest was for like 4 months. But she's been very willing to tell her story. And so in addition to photographs being really important, storytelling is really important in these crises. And then there was a big justice march in Detroit, and so we all marched together. It's just another way to get the word out. And this, we were in the water section, but there was also climate justice, and there was a section for air quality issues in Detroit. So there were several different segments, and we kind of led up the water segment. I include this here because one thing that people often don't think about when we think about the water crisis is the pets and how they're involved. And so they can't drink the water either, and just like a child who has a small body developing spring, you know, our huts are significantly smaller, and so the lead impacts them, you know, more as well. And so figuring out ways to make sure that you have bottled water for your pets. And, you know, one of the things, I think in one of the shops from Amy Goodman, there is a billboard that says, don't boil your water. And so that was something that people did in the beginning, but when you boil it, it actually concentrates the lead. And so it exacerbates the problem. And that's what people were doing for their pets. But it's just, you know, they didn't know. I think this is the last one. I love this image because I think it's pretty essential, Melissa, first of all, but she has never stopped fighting, and she's, you know, I was telling her the other day, she's really ill, but she travels so much, talking to people about this and working for solutions, like, tirelessly. She, like, never sleeps, and so I think that this image is just an awesome tribute to her and shows, like, her spirit. I think that would be it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Do you guys have any questions for us, just at where we're at right now, about Flint and the Flint story and what happened? How many of you guys knew about Flint before this? You knew a lot of that stuff? How many of you knew about Nestle and the involvement there? Yeah. Anybody from Flint, Michigan area? No? Okay.
So who's the mayor now? Like, who's the governor, who's the mayor?
So, same governor for just another 2 years.
he didn't want to become governor or mayor of Detroit. What was that?
No, I'll start with Flint. So, Flint got a new mayor, Karen Lieber. She's been great. She's really accessible. I think she was thrown into a spotlight she could never have anticipated, like how big things were going to get, and what exactly that burden would be for her. But I think she's done a really good job. But as you know, Flint is going through, they have the mayor and city council are up for election in November, and it is very contentious there right now. And you know, because so little progress has been made in terms of actually fixing the pipes, there's a lot of, you know, finger pointing and whatnot. So that's kind of where that is. The governor is still the governor. He has not been indicted on any charges, although 11 other government officials have been. And the state, the local, the county, the state, and federal level of the EPA. And so only time will tell if you know, what happens with him, but he has amassed a huge amount of money for his defense should what happen, and it's all taxpayer dollars. And the mayor of Detroit is a whole other story. I can tell you about that later. They have started replacing the pipes, and it's a slow process, and they're trying to do it in a way, I think that's really mindful. So one of the things to consider is that when you replace the pipes, if you're just replacing the service lines and the main pipes in the system, people still have lead pipes in their homes that have been destroyed. So those need to be replaced as well. But if you drive downstream in Flint, in a lot of neighborhoods, there might only be one house or two homes that actually have occupants in them. So then there's, well, what do we do with all these other homes who could be contributing to the problem and the water sitting in their pipes? And what we learned from Washington, D.C., so D.C. had their own lead crisis in 2004, is that if you do, it's called a partial line replacement, so if you only replace some of the lines, it actually makes the lead problem worse because you're disturbing the lead in the other pipes. So there is, you know, there is a plan, but the other thing is that they also don't know where all the lead pipes are. So that information was recorded on little read-by-by index cards. And so they're trying to figure out where actually the pipes are. So it's, you know, it's slow going. They only have a few months a year where it's really good weather to do it. So that's kind of where that seems. Yeah.
Have they considered a temporary water system?
You would think. One of the things that has been argued is that instead of providing bottled water, because it's really not easy to shower, clean your house, 12-ounce bottle of water, is provide people with the big water buffaloes and fill those up, but no. And it, I mean, they're connected to a safe water source now, it's just that the pipes are so deteriorated that, you know, there's only so much they can do.
Thought about things like rainwater
management. Yeah, and I think that that's, we actually had somebody contact us from North Carolina that came and installed the system, but I think that it's just like to be able to do it for everybody, it's just like it's not feasible. And so people do, I mean, they harvest water, they borrow water, they go outside the city to like shower or wash their clothes. People have become so resourceful. Like, it's really amazing how creative and resourceful people have.
Because she was asking about the rainwater collection, but is that even safe at this point?
It would have to be tested, but they have like filtration systems that so that you can catch the water and they're very expensive. And but I mean the ramifications of like that water going back into the system or into our lakes, rivers, and streams is also concerning. What is it doing?
How's the federal government not still in? It's not like it's busted or
so they did. Obama in January of 2016 declared national emergency and just freed up $5 million to go to the city, which really is a drop in the bucket. We appealed to the Department of Health and Human Services to declare a public health emergency. They denied that request several times because that would actually free up more money. What had been asked was to declare a disaster. And unfortunately, the way that our system is set up is that if it's a natural disaster, FEMA can come in, you can free up all this money. But if it's a human-made disaster, it doesn't. So if you're on the case, you've got to figure it out yourself.
So you said that in Flint that a lot of houses are currently abandoned. Is that something like it is in Detroit where it's already happening, or is that mostly because of the water?
No. So the cities are really similar. They were both automotive cities. So in Flint, it was GM who took the motors, and Fabricator worked with General Motors, and it was a really successful city until GM started closing their plants and making operations overseas. And so now it's a city of less than 100,000 people. One of the concerns with some of the activists that I've spoken with recently is that when they do the census in 2020, if Flint remains under 100,000 people, then the county can step in and take away certain things. And so they're kind of wanting to, what I've heard, and I don't know how much fact there is that they kind of want to redevelop and reinvent Flint and make it so that it's more of a college town, bring some blocks and exciting things to like the downtown area. And then what that does is it very akin to what's happening in Detroit, is the people who live there forever can no longer live there. So that seems to be what the plan is for Flint. about $800 a year for drinking water. Who do you think was the cheapest drinking water in the country? Go ahead, just give me a guess. Because this is shocking.
Phoenix.
Yes. Phoenix, Arizona, in the middle of the desert. They were paying, I can't remember what their rate was, but it was the cheapest of the 500 was Phoenix. So here you have Flint in the middle of the Great Lakes, in Phoenix in the middle of the desert, just like wrap your head around that. Impossible. Yeah, so they were paying for it. They got a partial reprieve, so for a while they were getting a 60, and I should say, their water rates were illegally raised 35%. In September of 2015, a judge agreed with that, ordered them to be decreased. And then later that following spring, they were given like a 65% credit on water bills. There was a temporary moratorium. And then just this past spring, so they had that for about a year before the state took it away because they said, oh, the water's all good, you gotta pay for the whole price. And so not only did they start shutting people off for non-payment, but in May they foreclosed on 8,002 residences for not paying their water bills. Because in Michigan you can tie them with the water bills to your property taxes. Yeah.
Yeah, actually, this is a quote from a pretty well-known performance artist that I've had in my office for the last few years. Before this piece, let's see, probably starting in 2012 or so, I started doing a project that I called Fracking Field Trips. So, you know, I started seeing these commercials on the TV. Many of you have probably seen them from the Colorado Little Gas Commission and say, you know, fracking's not a big deal, everything's fine, don't worry about it. So my thought was, well, if that's the case, then let's just, you know, do some field trips and head out there and see these fracking sites. What I was interested in with that project is kind of cutting out the element of representation. So a lot of times when we make art, most of the time when we make art, there's something, maybe that's conceptual or historical or theoretical or not, and then we produce a representation of it in order to tell that story. So with fracking field trips, I was basically trying to collapse concept and form, in a sense, going back to the source. There's a lot of this in the history of art, especially recently. There's an artist I love named Tanya Bruguera, who's well known for saying that she is not interested in art about the thing, she's interested in art that is the thing. And so this Kanji quote, I think he was hoping for something more beautiful than Flint water, but I see the Flint water over there in the same shape. This is a piece by Pedro Reyes. It's called Sanatorium, and this is in Mexico City. Basically what this is a health clinic, a mental health clinic. It's run all by people, no experts, just run by the community. So early in this talk, Ned was amazed saying, you're the expert in your crisis. And I think that's something that's been occurring. You see it happening in socially engaged art. You see artists starting to maybe overstep their bounds and start to work. So in other words, instead of me making a video about the story of me, and I could just bring the water here, but following the lines of Pedro Reyes, the next step would be, as a work of art, we're going to start doing our own water quality tests. So Reyes and Bruguera both have some of these similar ideas, and I know there's a few art students in the crowd here. If I could just be theoretical for a moment, this is the operations manual to Pedro Reyes' sanatorium. And in the beginning of the book here, he talks about this anthropologist named Michael Taussig, who wrote a bunch of books in the 80s. And Taussig had sort of, all of his research was in anthropology, but what he was after was the relationship in society between people and the state. So I'm going to read this little passage for you. This is a long answer to your question about my logic, the artwork here. But Taussig was a former doctor from Australia, and in 1982 he wrote a book called The Nervous System. So what he he did as an anthropologist is he started looking at, like Reyes, he started looking at clinical clinics, the healthcare industry and the medical industry. So he wrote this book called The Nervous System, and in the book he basically uses the nervous system as a theoretical sort of structure to talk about what the medical clinic cannot contain or resolve or deal with. And so the nervous system is that. So let's see. Using stunning examples taken from his career in the medical field, Taussig demonstrates that one of the main problems facing our society, and this is in 1982, is what he calls, quote, the reification of the consciousness of the patient. In other words, Taussig analyzes the way medical practice lies in between a, quote, cultural construction of clinical reality and the clinical construction of culture, unquote. It considers its patients' bodies as pure mechanics that suffer from various dysfunctions that define them as sick or ill objects to be repaired through contemporary technologies of healing. Healthcare. Following his point of view, patients are not considered individuals who can express the form of reaction, one might say, of fatigue to social situations through physical symptoms. They are simply reified as most of the goods that capital puts at the center of the global exchange. So what Reyes is saying in the clinic here is that he's, as an artist, he's tired of patients being in service of the clinic. He wants the clinic to return to being in service of the patient. So what I see happening in the clinic is the same exact phenomenon. The body of the clinic citizens are in service of the state. The state made all those decisions. In fact, lying and betraying the citizens. Read those decisions not only based on the body of the state, not body of the citizens, but based on its own body as a profit-making machine. This is kind of the theoretical underpinning between them with the piece. It's kind of interesting too, if you go, if you know any ceramics, or you study any pottery, if you go on the web and you Google vessel or vase, you'll notice that throughout many cultures, a picture like that has a neck, has a belly, has a tongue. So one of my sort of things that I'm interested in with this piece is water never really leaves a watershed. On the planet we have the same amount of water that we'll always have. Whether we pollute it or keep it clean, it's always going to be the same amount. And when we drink water, our bodies basically absorb that water, right? So there's a sacred bond between our bodies and the water that's been broken. And a vessel throughout thousands of years in various cultures has been defined as a metaphor for thought. So I think there's something really interesting there. I've got a few examples of some artwork here, and I don't have the names written down, but this is a piece that's Deep Water Horizon. So again, these are some other artworks recently that made me think of ways you could bring water, kind of the way that Lynn and I did into the show. This is a really famous piece. This is Yang One from the 1997 Venice Biennale, To Raise the Water on it. I think what he's saying here with this piece, this is a little bit more maybe conceptual. They all stand in the pond, a big group of people, and they try to raise the water. But it's similar to Reyes's work in that it's participatory, it's collective, and it's essentially a social action. So I think this kind of falls in line with what Melissa Mays is saying, that we have to be the experts in our own crisis. If you look at the news, what's happened recently with Harvey and Irma, we saw it with Katrina. If you talk to anybody down there, the people on the ground are taking care of themselves. I don't want to sound like a conspiracy theorist here, but we're at a point where our state is not doing what it needs to do. In fact, it's doing quite the opposite. So I'm seeing a sort of similarity between recent contemporary art practices that want to depart from representation of the beautiful, representation of the poetic, and start to enter into that civic reality of that we have to take care of ourselves and set up these our own structures. This is one that made me think of Nestle. The Nestle situation, this is obviously Coke, but here we are. We may think we're drinking Coke, but actually, if you follow Taussig's theory about the nervous system and the body politic and that sort of betrayal, we're all laying face down with a Coke bottle forced down our throats, essentially. And then this is from 2007, I believe. This is right before Occupy Wall Street. This is a Danish design collective called Superflex. And they did a series, it's actually a really interesting video, they call Flooded McDonald's. Somehow they got their hands on more or less all the materials from an older McDonald's, recreating the design. and then flooded it. And they have this starter statement, which is like, you know, we're hearing so much about sea level rise and all this stuff. And so I think they just kind of wanted to flip the script and show us that the same sort of corporate causes of the potential flooding and sea level rise that we're going to have are going to flood those spaces as much as they're going to flood houses or that kind of thing. So yeah, I've been interested lately in any time I could sort of collapse forming concept. So with the water just having appeared, in one sense, it's a way to get to know Lynn and hear the story of what we're doing today, have Lynn kind of talk and tell us the details about Lynn. That piece is, like Cecily said at the beginning, is probably just the beginning of what artists can do. Most of my practice as an artist, I'm really not interested in this situation, the gallery. I'm much more interested in being out in public and doing things, trying to access things. I know this is kind of weird for not a professor to say, but I feel like there's a state of crisis for art right now, and it's revolving around our all of our old ideologies of telling stories and representing things that I think are being called into question. And this last slide I have here is probably pretty interesting. Oh, okay, this is kind of a, I forget what he calls it, but this is Ai Weiwei, right? Some of you probably know Ai Weiwei. He was one of the architects on the Bird's Nest in the Beijing Olympics. He's probably one of the world's most famous artists. And this is a performance he does where he drops, I believe it's a replica, but it's a Ming Dynasty piece, right? And so there's a lot of ways to interpret this piece. One is just in the China context that heading up to the Olympics, there was so much gentrification and scraping of buildings that this is essentially what China is doing to itself prepare for the Olympics. But I also think as an artist, to me, this represents the metaphor of breaking the tradition, kind of just dropping the old ways we've been working and moving on. So the other thing I wanted to share with you, these are just some of my influences with this piece as an artist. Some of you probably know Lucy LaPard. She's a really well-known writer and artist. She has written for many years. This is a book called Undermining, A Wild Ride Through Land Use, Politics, and Art in the Changing West. And it's not exactly, it doesn't quite fit what we're dealing with here in Flint. You know, the West is a much more of a, as an artist, it's really easy to work with the West. I'd love to see a book like this about that piece. But she's got a nice passage in here. Where she talks about art a little bit. An increasing number of artists and activists are taking up the land use challenges, not just shooting photographs of undermining, but digging deeper, so to speak, into the underlying issues. Chiseled on the facade of an old grammar school in Fort Benton, Montana, is this admonition: industry is useless without culture. This is some graffiti that she sees in Montana. A message that still resonates in this post-industrial age. Culture is a far broader term than art, and can embrace social energies not yet recognized as art. And that's something that I'm interested in as an artist and as an art teacher, is trying to stay in that wider cultural arena and sort of figuring out what are those situations that, of something that might not yet be recognized as art, but that I can bring into art school. If much contemporary art appears divorced from the popular expectations of quote fine arts, it remains a way of seeing. Sometimes more connected to or embedded in life than previously expected. While entangling visual arts with the cold realities of our current environment, some artists are realizing that they can envision alternative futures. Produce redemptive and restorative vehicles with which to open cracks in the other world and rehabilitate the world of new imagination. Artists are good at slipping between the institutional walls to expose the layers of emotional and aesthetic resonance in our relationships to place. They can ask questions without worrying about answers. And then she goes to continue on to talk about her seminal book, Deliver the Local, which is 1997. And she talks about writing about conceptual feminist and political art as escape attempts. And I think in some ways when I talk about art being a crisis of representation, that piece in a way as an escape attempt. When the installation was happening here, Anna was working for days and days and days on this beautiful installation, and I came and poured some water from Flint into a vase you know, and then kind of went to lunch. And in a way, that's kind of my own escape attempt. But I want to finish here with what Marcia's doing. So she's concluded that the ultimate escape attempt would be to free ourselves from the limitations of preconceived notions of art, and in doing so, help save the planet. So, you know, a few years ago, we had a once-in-a-thousand-year flood in 2013. Here, Emoka did a show pretty quickly in response to the floods, and I wrote an essay in the catalog of that show. And it was an interesting process. At the time, I was working with an editor. I didn't know I was working with an editor, but there was an editor who was reviewing my manuscript. I kept getting my manuscript back with these comments like, I don't understand why he's saying this, and you know, you can't write about art in this way. And so one of the things I was saying in that essay was that these floods, and this is known to climate scientists, they're breaking all our models. We literally don't have models anymore to measure what's happening to our environment. So that means our economic models are going to break, our governmental models are going to break, our religious models might break, and if all those are going to break, then why wouldn't our art models also break? So in the essay, I don't have the answer here. In the essay, I'm calling into question, art is going to go. And if we're going to live under these circumstances, art has to totally change its ideology into something else. And I think emerging from that is going to just be necessary and sort of unavoidable. We can organize or starve, basically. So I know I didn't want this talk to be like too much of a heavy hammer or too depressing. I do teach a class called Socially Engaged Art at MSU Denver. I've taught it now for 6 years. It's the only socially engaged art class at an undergraduate university in the state of Colorado. And so this is what I do, this is kind of what I'm working on. This is phase one. Phase two would be some sort of something that looks like Pedro Reyes' this sanatorium where we're all sort of leading experts in our own crisis. So there, you asked about the art. And I just kind of unloaded for you all of my theories. I was going to read a clip from you from Carmen Rivera. You can find it on the web if you want, but she's known for her manifestos. There's a couple that I would recommend. One is, it's on her website, it's called Political Art. And it's basically her position on political art. So if I can tell you a little bit more about Carmen Rivera, some examples of her work. She started out as a performance artist, similar to me, trying to embody the work. So that's a common step you see with social media artists. A lot of us early on started doing performance art. When you do performance art, you're basically, you know, you're critiquing the divide between artist artwork. So that binary of artist artwork, which is a really modern idea, is called into question. Because there's no one, you know, you are the one. But she started sort of taking it a step further. So in New York, she opened up a pro bono law clinic for people who need help with immigration issues as a work of art. She used grant funding from the art world to set up this storefront. She organized attorneys and they started running this free law clinic on immigration. So that's the actuality that she's interested in. You know? And I guess I'm getting more and more interested in that kind of thing too. So read her thing on political art if you have a chance. Last year she was the commencement address at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago, and she gave that. And so there's a transcript of that on her website, and that's also really powerful. So she's been a big influence for me. Her opinion is more than the city. And Taussig, his idea of the nervous system, if you ever have a chance and you want to read, some really kind of out there cultural anthropology and theory, read the nervous system. It's 1982. He talks early on in the book about returning from abroad in Australia, being on a ferry, coming into, I think, Brisbane or Melbourne at an immigration checkpoint and getting out of this ferry. And here's this immigration checkpoint, and there's like all these buildings, and it narrows into a chain link fence corridor where everyone's forced to go through it. And as he's going through this immigration checkpoint, off to the side, he sees graffiti on the wall. It's interesting, he sees graffiti and so does Lucille Parks. It just says the nervous system. And that's kind of where he got this idea for the book. But he starts equating the structures of the nervous system with those types of checkpoints, like an immigration checkpoint. So that immigration checkpoint is where our social body starts to become nervous. That structural sort of design of putting bodies through a checkpoint is starting to click and become sort of unmanageable, unmeasurable, that kind of thing. So he's a really interesting person to look at in terms of this idea that the state and capital has co-opted us, essentially, and our functions are in service of it. So maybe projects like this, or where people have done the plant, if you think about plant, they tested their own water. You know, they started literally doing everything themselves, which was a way to sever that tie with the state, right? I mean, they were betrayed by the state and lied to, so they had no choice. But what I guess what I'm saying is, for artists, that severing can be an aesthetic choice. Yeah.
I would say too, we've talked about this in terms of the role that art plays in activism. It's crucial because it's a way to make an issue more approachable to more people. And so, when you talk about the performance aspect of it, I think about, you know, we're, as an organizer, you're always trying to get media attention for the issues, and everybody wants to do, like, you call a reporter, they want a visual. And so that has been something that we've really worked, I think, even more so over the last, like, 5 or 10 years to integrate into our campaigns as some sort of performance or some sort of visual, because that's what the media wants. And then that helps you in turn tell the story about whatever it is that you're working on. So it's crucial to be able to do that. Mm-hmm.
Any other questions for us? It's also a little bit of conceptual art too, which is, you know, always fun.
Why didn't you guys use the microphones?
Sorry.
Because the ventilation really
spoiled
the voices so much. It was wonderful information, wonderful content, but I wish I could have heard it all.
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, I'm happy to talk
now
about
it. Now it's really nice.
Yeah.
I mean, when that,
yeah,
that's going, it's just,
yeah,
really welcome.
We just kind of forgot.
Yeah. Makes sense. It was a wonderful presentation.
Yeah, so you know, a few months ago I started sketching out some ideas, and I think I would like to figure out a way as an art project to teach myself how to test air quality, water quality, and soil quality. And so, I mean, it almost sounds too heavy-handed to say, but if anything, creativity sits on top of these very basic human needs. But also maybe creativity just needs to insert itself into understanding those needs. So, you know, I like artworks that are participatory, where audience members have a stake in the work and can have an impact in the work. So, some sort of clinic, like what Pedro did with the sanatorium, you know, where we can start to become experts in our own crisis. And then, you know, because I'm a professor and I'm always doing research, anytime I can connect with somebody outside of my field, you know, is always really fun and important just in my life. So learning how to test soil quality, air quality, water quality, I would need some people, I'm sure, to do that. So, the fracking field trips, I mean, that happened over a 2 or 3 year period, and then just kind of, I just had enough of going out to see fracking sites. And if you've been north of Denver, you know that going to see a fracking site is kind of a ridiculous notion. There's thousands of them. But I went for a few years with different groups of people. We would take a bunch of cars and we would go out and just get out and pick one and start walking around and taking pictures of it, sketching it, you know, that kind of thing. So I don't know. I don't have a specific next great art idea answer for you. It's unrelated politically, but it's similar artistically. But this 2 summers ago, I started working on a project. I made the world's largest PDF. So I also do, I do get a lot of internet art. So I went on the web and just found every PDF I could download that had the world's largest in the title and the description. And then if you've ever used Acrobat, you can just combine multiple PDFs and export them as a new PDF. So I exported this like 16 gigabyte world's largest PDF. So it's a little different, But for me, the logic is the same there. Like, as an artist, like taking the idea and the form of something and trying to just fold it into one thing. Yeah.
Kind of interesting, these fracking field trips you were talking about. Were they wells that were currently in the process of being fracked and drilled, or were they already just...
Yeah, so we were only able to go to one drilling site. So, you know, I would describe them in kind of three ways. You'll see active drilling sites, and if you're driving along I-25 or 76 or something, those are typically the ones that have fencing, really that sort of absurd fencing.
Yeah.
It's like two stories high.
Yeah.
The kind of fencing they'll use when they put us all in like a camp someday. fencing like that. So there's active drilling sites. Once it's drilled, it's kind of hard to tell whether the site, whether the well is active or not.
Sure.
One interesting thing, this is just like Nestle with how easily they get their hands on the aquifers. The oil and gas industry, they can drill horizontally, first of all. So they can go down to the well site and then it's like having five straws in your Coke. And then once they go down, they can send pipes horizontally to other locations and then go down. The only way to really tell if a well is active is if a gas truck comes to pull gas out of the storage tanks. Or at night, you'll see those active wells burning out their methane emissions, which has skyrocketed in the Front Range. They're now measuring methane in Rocky Mountain National Park something like five or six times its historical average. So that methane cloud, if you live in here in Denver, has already been to the mountains. What they do with that sort of speculation is it's so cost efficient for them to drill, but they will just about randomly drill. And if they suck oil out of a well for a while, it's no skin for them to just shut it down and leave it. So the next phase for those of us that live in Denver and Colorado, frankly, will be remediation of what used to be, you know, one of America's great agricultural areas. North of Denver really is now essentially a burned out oil field, you know? So that's a kind of long answer to your question. So we would go to all three of those sites, yeah.
And how did they react to you taking photographs of
sites? So the one time we went to the drilling site where they were actively drilling, it was such a huge project, I don't think they cared. We parked on the side of the road and got out, we didn't enter the site. Somebody did come out and we asked them some questions and talked to them. Only one other time did we have somebody stop by, and we were out on the dirt road, really, really close to the Halliburton headquarters. So this is also folded into the oil and gas story. I mean, Flint has a story, but we have our story here too. So a guy came driving by in a Halliburton truck, and one of the people I was with, who used to be a professor here in Phoenix, used to teach photo. She had hopped the fence and was taking better photos than she could have without hopping the fence. Into the well site. This guy drives by in a truck, rolls down his window and asks us who we are. And this is the fun part about being an artist. You just say, I'm an artist. Which is, you know, it's like official, but what does that mean? You know? So he was sort of taken back by that, but he asked us why we didn't have hard hats, you know, and so we were able to get into a conversation with him about the supposed safety. But he was, you could see in his body language that we were endangered by being on the site. Yeah. So that's the one interaction.
There's an interesting connection too between fracking and water. So it's especially Flint. So on average, one of those horizontal wells, it's about 5 million gallons to frack it, although depending on your substrate, it can go up to like 25 million gallons of water. That water is so toxic. Well, first of all, you only get about 75% of it back that you can't use it. They can't right now, we don't have the technology to clean it, so it is then injected back into the ground in these injection wells, which are the ones that are causing the earthquakes. We can't use it. So it's taking it completely out of our watershed forever.
Yeah.
And in Flint, the reason they switched off the water system, the safe water system to begin with, was because they were gonna build a new pipeline from Lake Huron to Flint. And part of the reasoning behind that, they think, is to frack for natural gas and oil in the thumb area of Michigan. So it's all...
Yeah. Yeah, when I was out there doing the fracking field trips, what Lynn is saying is totally true. That you'd also see, you'll see huge piles of sand occasionally, like sort of like an empty lot, and there'll be piles of sand that are several stories high. And this is sand that they put in with the water and the chemical mix, and it's the pressurized water sand chemicals that actually frack or crack the shale, which then releases the methane. So all that sand, apparently, is, a lot of that sand is coming from southern New Mexico, but it's also coming from the Driftless area in Wisconsin, which is another Great Lakes area. That's a big glacial gift, essentially, all these lakes and all these aquifers, but also those glaciers pushed a whole bunch of sand up into this area of Wisconsin that's known as the Driftless area. That sand's being strip mined, trucked to Colorado, dumped on an empty farm, and then injected into fracking wells. So somehow we've decided that not only should we totally ruin this water and make it toxic beyond measurable human time, but the best thing to do with it is just inject it in the ground and don't worry about it for a while. So, yeah.
So what stops it from getting into the aquifers?
Nobody knows.
Don't they encase it in concrete or something?
They do. Yeah. So the walls themselves are, they should be double walled. But the thing, I mean, with any of this, like we saw with Deepwater Horizon, is you have a person or people that are doing this, and you know, humans are fallible. Like you can make an error, or that cement can crack, and so there's nothing really. You know, it's whatever.
It just makes you wonder about landscape art, for example. Should we all go out to the fracking area and do some plein air paintings? No, this is what I mean about the crisis for all of our notions of aesthetics of beauty and the sublime and all these things that we rely on to view and experience art. They're all folded into our environment, and that's being destroyed. And therefore, I think the language of art is really boring. The language and the experience of art, like everything else, is becoming increasingly vulnerable. So the only way to survive would be to shift it somehow. You know, to essentially, as artists and art viewers, to somehow be on the run from what we've always done. To be on the run, meaning like, what are the structures and methods and languages we can come up with to deal with the day-to-day occurrences we're noticing. Yeah. I know, it's not the kind of art that an opening read, like the pat on the back and the cheers, like, you know, where you go, Matt? You know? I'd like to buy that.
Yeah. I think it's super interesting because, like, once upon a time, art, like, in medieval times, art was a way to communicate to people and ways of living very much in a very similar way. It was a very important message that was trying to be brought across through artwork. So, in a sense, you're trying to do the same thing through activism.
Yeah.
But I feel like I come up against this sometimes, like when I suggested an idea of some sort in a certain situation, I'm not just say for what I thought was creative at the time, and being called out for being too literal or like,
right.
You know.
Yeah.
Can you come across that?
Oh, totally. I mean, I struggled as an art student, actually, you know. There's this kind of implicit assumption that you come across as an art student from a lot of art professors, that whatever the thing is, the job of the artist is to actually just recreate the thing. You know, and I guess that's exactly what you're saying. So there's this way of looking down upon actuality, you know. Even though we've got definitely a legacy of realism sort of being prefaced and valued, and that tradition of realism can be heavily masculine, really rely on male gaze. And what does that even mean, you know? So, yeah, I totally, that's been a lot of my experience. If you read that Tanya Gregoris thing on political art, she addresses that. She actually addresses it in her commencement speech at the School of the Art Institute. All of her experiences with being told, you're not on the right path as an artist, we're not sure your ideas are appropriate. I've read that about Jenny Holzer, I've read it about Ai Weiwei, you know? So maybe the trick to being an artist is to ignore. I don't know, you have to trust your instincts, I guess, you know?
It also seems challenging, like you were saying, like some of my friends would say, well, who's gonna buy that, you know?
And yeah.
What do you see, like, you know, this is a different kind of art, you may not necessarily be looking for a feature of that particular piece.
Right. Yeah. Socially engaged art, kind of as a field, has become almost trendy. And you see, like, now there's a couple graduate programs you can do MFAs in social engaged art. Just the better the art department has social engaged art as a class or even as a concentration. The good thing that's happened in the last 10 years of social engaged art is there are a lot of institutions that are starting to become involved in terms of funding. So there are grants, there's publications, there's peer-reviewed publications. So there's some legitimacy happening in social engaged art. The flip side of it is a lot of social engaged art right now is sort of too positive. So it's solutions oriented. So artists are going to come along and address this issue. And so you see this in the city of Denver. A lot of cities have started funding social engaged art projects, but only in ways that tie into the narrative that the city wants to have. When a lot of really good social engaged art, frankly, just throws a brick through the window. You know, it's pretty antagonistic. At least half of the field is somewhat antagonistic, like what Ai Weiwei is doing. And some of the more bold artists aren't offering solutions to problems. They're just using aesthetics to point out the problem that everyone's kind of ignoring. So I guess at the very least, there's some grants and there's some things happening. So there is a financial world that you can live in if you're an activist artist. It's never going to be the opening, black tie opening at the MoMA, I don't think. But, yeah.
It can sustain.
Yeah. Thanks for coming out and telling you guys. Thanks for having me.